Hey. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
How are you doing?
Awesome.
Wonderful.
Day 10?
Yeah.
Service 10?
Yeah.
It's been awesome.
Oh, yeah.
It's been wonderful. It's been glorious.
Yes.
We want to welcome everybody here tonight. We want to welcome all our visitors. Great to have you out tonight. Are you expecting?
Yes.
What are you expecting?
The Holy Ghost, God.
Holy Ghost, God, everything. Prophecy, words, revelation. Gold, gold, gold. Amen. It's been great. So we just thank the Lord for his goodness. It's been such an awesome week with Brother Begley. And it's just been, you know, he kind of asks sometimes when we leave the service, he says, did you get anything? And I'm just like,
oh, yeah.
I don't even know what to say. Like, I'm getting so much that I have no answer what to say. My mind is just going and trying to process everything.
Yeah.
But it's been awesome. Amen?
Yeah.
Well, why don't we stand up and let's open up in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just worship you tonight. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. We just humble ourselves before you tonight. We yield ourselves to you. We ask you to anoint our ears with ear salve to hear what the Spirit is saying to us tonight. We ask that the spirit of revelation and knowledge will flow tonight. We pray for the manifestation of all the gifts of the Spirit to be in full manifestation. Father, we ask you to show up big and manifest yourself here tonight. Father, we're going to lift you up in praise and worship. And you said, God, that you inhabit the praises of your people. So as we praise you tonight, we worship you, God. Father, we know your presence is filling this place even right now. And we give you glory and honor and praise for all that you're doing and all you're going to do and accomplish in this meeting tonight. May it be glorious in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, one thing you like to do around here is go around and greet one another. Now, if you are don't want anybody to hug you or love on you, just kind of just wave hi.
That's right. We'll respect them. Go ahead.
We're together again. Just praise the Lord. Promises. Amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
I have a promise that I can't stand. the world. It couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, treasures that fade, are never enough. You came along. We'll be back together. Here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. I searched the world. Oh, there's nothing better than you.
Oh,
I've got one response. I've got just one move. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song.
Fredericton today, I heard the Lord speak this song to me. And he showed me a picture of a heart that was all chained up. All chained up and can't function and can't do what it's supposed to do. Pumping that life out to, you know, every part of the body and wherever life is needed. And I heard these words, the Spirit saying, I'm coming to unravel hearts that have been paralyzed by shame. So when I sing this, I want you to just put your hand on your heart. And he goes, I want you to ask this on my behalf. I want you to ask this. Can I come and heal your heart? I thought, well, of course you can come heal hearts, Holy Spirit, your Holy Spirit. He goes, yes, but I need your yes. I want your heart. Can I have your heart? Yes. Yes. Whatever you want, Holy Spirit. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with songs of deliverance.
Oh, I'm no longer. Changes. Fire. It's where's our fire? How it Praise the Lord. Hey, come on, praise the Lord. I want to hear you, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Come on, you can do better than your neighbor, praise the Lord. God bless you. Thank you, Daddy, for the opportunity to be here and can cite Prophet Neil and the wonderful wife. God bless you. And all the men of God in the house, God bless you all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
My wonderful sister, God bless you. Sister Kim, God bless you. I'm always blessed under your ministration. May God continue to increase you in Jesus' name. Amen. At the Better Life Church, we have it's an annual event coming up this Saturday and Sunday, 23rd and 24th of this month. Daddy will be there with his wife. Prophet Neil will be there with his wife. And we have some other ministers, you know, that will grace the occasion. It's going to be a wonderful time in the presence of God.
Amen.
And like Daddy said, there are some flyers here. If you want to be part of it, the flyers will go around. And we are trusting God for great outpouring of the Spirit of the living God. And of course, Sister Kim will be ministering to us also that day. God bless you, sir.
Thank you so much. Everybody's invited. So we have Pastor Lois with Pastor Lois. Come on up for just a moment. Sunday night is Holy Ghost night here, so we just endeavor to just go with the flow, but then all of our services are Holy Ghost anyway. But we just, you know, it's early. We've got, you know, usually we start at 7, but on Sunday next we start at 6, so that gives us an extra 2 or 3 hours tonight.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Well, thank you. I've been blessed by the worship and just by, I needed some filling, okay? I've had several things happening over the last year or so, and I just needed to, I've been going to places to get filled, and I knew I could hear because it's full of the Holy Spirit. So I've been hearing a lot about it, of course, through my friend Kim, and so thank you. Thank you for, I'm glad to be here.
Amen. Amen. All right, well, we have Pastor Emma. Pastor, come on up here. Hallelujah. Prophet Neil, come on up here. Okay. We met Pastor Emily some time ago, and she's been, she would come on Sunday nights, and she'd come over and bless us. Oh, my goodness, we were blessed, and then her preaching just was so inspiring, and so, it gets us so fired up, and then she started saying, well, you know, her husband was way, way up north, what Brother Begley talks about. I hear about her way up north. Well, he was way up north. You're up in Pond Inlet, in Pond Inlet, and that's where, if you've ever heard the video or heard the tape of when the Holy Spirit came through a church in Pond Inlet, it's amazing. He was there.
Wow.
This is where he has been up at working. Now he's back down here with us. And so, but Shari said, you know, you ought to hear my husband preach. And I thought, well, he couldn't get any better than Pastor Emma, maybe. But oh my goodness. It did. So listen, I'm gonna ask a favor. Is it all right? Would you mind singing tonight?
I will.
Okay, Pastor Emma. Yeah. She, Pastor Kim, anyway, come on up here. Up there. Up there. You need to come. Conference with her. Anyway, they have so blessed our church. They have so blessed us. And they pastor Victory Tabernacle. It's just outside of Fredericton here, out past Clarney Lake, out on the Clarney Road. And but we really have grown to love them and appreciate them. And the fire that they have, the passion that they have for the Word of God and the things of God. So inspiring. And so if you're ever looking for somebody to come and preach someplace, you might want to get a hold of these people, because they know how to turn things around. Amen?
Amen.
You know what to do now?
I do. Hallelujah. Thank you, Pastor. I greet you all in the wonderful name of Jesus. Isn't he an awesome God tonight?
Yes.
Amen. Every time I come in, I just feel like I'm coming home, because I love the spirit of worship in this house. I was just getting lost back there in the Holy Ghost. And I'm just excited about what the Lord is going to do in this house tonight. You know, I posted this week this statement. It says, whatever is wrong in your life is not bigger than what's right with the Lord. So, you know, you might have came with all kinds of problems and situations tonight, but the answer is here. Amen. Your healing's here. Your breakthrough is here. Your deliverance is here. Hallelujah. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Amen. There's a liberty. Give Jesus to carry
you and put you in my door.
Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 He's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise your mighty name. Come on, somebody just worship him in the house tonight. Oh, he's here to heal. He's here to deliver. Amen. He's here with your miracle, with your breakthrough. All you've got to do is just reach out into the atmosphere and pull it down. We lose some freedom in this house. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We give you glory, Lord. Oh, for you are high and lifted up in this house. And your train, it fills the temple. It fills the temple. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. lift up a praise tonight. And he's been awesome in your life, and he's been mighty in your life, and he brought you where nobody else could bring you from, and he made a way where there was no way, and he healed your body, and he filled you with his spirit. Oh, I'm excited tonight, church. I'm excited.
Churches, and we're not in competition.
That's right.
We are not in competition. We cooperate with each other. I'm praying for them. God, fill them up. There's enough sinners here for all of us to be on the phone. Brother Neil, Papa Neil, we are so blessed to have you.
Amen. Well, thank you, Pastor.
God bless you.
Hallelujah. Well, somebody clap your hands for the Lord tonight. Amen. It's truly a privilege and an honor to be here. I greet all the ministers that are in the place, all the pastors. In ministry, it gets busy, and time is something that is very precious. And so when I'm out evangelizing, when another minister comes out to one of my meetings, I always count it a privilege and an honor. And so to have as many visiting pastors in the place, it is a blessing. But it is also a testimony for your pastor. I thank the Lord for the pastor of this house and the anointing of God that's upon his life.
Yes.
And he's right. We're not in competition. We're working together to build the kingdom of heaven.
Yes.
As far as I look around, when I look at the numbers of the city or the people that live within this city, there is no church that is big enough to hold everybody within this city. And I don't believe that one person could lead a city like this. I believe that it is a body ministry. It is the body that comes together to lead the body of Christ. I believe the greatest days of our church are yet ahead of us, and they're not behind us. Over the last several weeks, we've been doing a walk through the book of Acts, and I just want to challenge everybody that's in the place. If you're a part of the New Testament church, you just read the book of Acts. If you want to know what kind of church we're supposed to be, I believe we are that Book of Acts church. I believe that's the church that Jesus left, that he is coming back for. I believe that was the church that, as he was ascending up into heaven, that those two angels stood by and said, "Hey, you Galileans, why are you standing here looking up in amazement? This same Jesus that you've seen is going to return in like manner." I believe that one day he's coming back. But I believe one day he's coming back to take his church out of this world. And I don't know about you, but I want to be a part of that church. I just want to thank the Lord over the last few days. I've been tuning in via the internet, listening to Prophet Begley. I appreciate his ministry. And I want to thank the Lord for the door being open that God could bring a prophet to our city. The Bible said that if you bless a prophet in the name of a prophet, that you would receive a prophet's reward. And so I urge you and I challenge you to bless this man of God. I thank the Lord for the word that's been coming out. I've been amening along as I've been listening. And I want to thank the Lord that he opened the door that I could come out tonight to sit in the service live. You know, you see people that get excited about the football games and about the Super Bowl. And here in Canada, I grew up in the city of Regina, and there they had a stadium that was an outside stadium, and there was no roof on it. And I remember as we were getting closer to the winter, when they would have football games, Brother Begley, it would be snowing. And they would be in the crowds, and they'd have blankets, and they would be cheering, and they would be hooraying. And I asked the person one day, "Why is it that you face the cold to go sit there and watch the game?" I said, "Why wouldn't you just watch it at TV?" I said, "Those cameras will give you a better view." I said, "You'll be comfortable and warm on your chair." I said, "And it won't cost you an arm and a leg for all the snacks that you get at the game." The man one day looked at me and said, "Well, there's a difference." And I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "There's nothing like being there in person." He said, "You can watch it online, you could watch it on television, but there's nothing like being at the game in person." And I'm telling you, it's like that when it comes to church. You experience one thing on the internet, you experience one thing on television. How many of you know the Bible said that in these last days that we're not supposed to neglect the assembling of ourselves? Come on, somebody say amen. I'm a strong believer that there's something special that takes place when God's people of faith get together. The Bible said where two or three are gathered, there He is in the midst. I believe the Lord is in the midst, and I believe that God's going to do something great. Somebody clap your hands.
Hallelujah. We've been home now. Well, after the offering, of course. Say we've been to church. But it's just awesome. When we have other awesome people of God, men, women, and of course, listen, you're all awesome.
Yes.
You're all awesome. And you know, all of us are, you know, are different. We have different callings, different anointings, but you're very, very special. We want to take up our Wednesday night. That's a Sunday night. This is our Sunday night church offering for Word of Faith Church. And it says over in 1 John 1:7, it says, but walk in the light as He is in the light. Okay? You can't walk in light that you don't have. And when you get the light of giving, you get the light of tithing, and you understand that there is a light you can walk in, there's blessings. I love to give. I live to give. Thank you for the one. That's right. Maybe you're not, maybe you don't have light on that yet. Ask God to give you light. How many want to prosper? How many would like to have more? Well, I don't want to be greedy. Well, learn to get greedy. You can give more to the prophet, Brother Begley. Get greedy.
Yes.
The more you, you know, I never seen anybody that worked at a job and they offered them a raise. I said, no, I'm sorry. I don't want a raise. I just want to stay where I'm at. That's just too much money for me. Well, you know what? God wants to bless you. Okay? You know, there's people that have a poverty mentality.
Right, yeah.
And they just think, well, you know, that's just too much. It's too much. You know, it's too much money to give to a man of God. And but yet you see reporters ambush a preacher, ambush them, and just try to shame them because they have a nice house or they have a plane or something like that. But they never seem to ambush any football players, baseball players, tennis players. Or politicians. They don't mind politicians getting rich. Okay? But don't let a pastor, a prophet prosper. You know? Wow, man, that's just terrible. They're just ripping the people off. You know? Hallelujah. Well, time for God's people to prosper.
Yes.
You know, we realize, Brother Baker, maybe he'll speak on it tonight. I don't know where he's going to go tonight, but we realize, he talked a little bit about this morning, there is a move of the Spirit of God that is coming. Of gifts of the Spirit, and just tremendous to wake to get the world's attention. But then there's also going to come a move of prosperity to the body of Christ. You see, if God can get it through you, He can get it to you.
Yes.
I was pumping gas one time, and at the gas stations, they got these big lotto things, and it says, you know, 50 million and 80 million. And sometimes your mind, you just begin to daydream and think, man, Lord, if I had $50 million, if I had $50 million, Lord, I could give, many people in our church, families, I could give them $1 million. And the Lord said to me, that's the reason I won't let you win it. I said, what?
Yeah.
He said, because it would ruin so many of their lives.
Yeah. Wow.
Because if you had $1 million, we would find you belly up in the Bahamas. Oh, no, I'll use it. No. If you would use it for the kingdom of God and God's glory, He will use you.
Amen.
If He can get it through you, He can get it to you. So this is our Sunday night offer. Amen. Kathy O'Hare, come up here, please. I want you to pray over our offer tonight. I haven't had you. I love Pastor Kathy. She is she teaches our Tuesday night prayer. She does our. We have a couple times a month on Friday morning. We have something we call War Room, and that is just simply a more intense time of prayer because we live in a capital. And in the capital, you've got different kind of demons than you've got in other cities. Because this is where the laws are made, and this is where politicians make decisions and things like that. So if the devil can corrupt people's minds in a stronger way here, and so we come against the devil here. We realize he's real, but God is bigger. Amen. Hallelujah. He's already pulled his teeth anyway, so we realize that. Would you bless the offering? Go ahead, Dudley.
Thank you, Lord. We thank you. We bless you tonight, Lord. We worship you. We praise you. You're awesome. You're a great, great God, oh God. We thank you, Lord, tonight for the offering, for that you give us, Lord, that we can give, and you will give back to us. Lord, we thank you that you give us, you provide for us our protection, you provide prosperity for us, and Lord, we just thank you tonight. We thank you, God, that you provide everything we need. Everything we need is in you, oh God. And we thank you for this offering tonight, Lord. We ask that you would bless it, Lord, that it would be used for your kingdom, and then that you will give back to us, oh God, so that we can give again. In Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Thank you. Sister Falaki, you look beautiful as always. Maria, you look very nice too, okay? I don't know where you are. But we are a very, very blessed people. And Brother Begley was scheduled to be in Halifax last Sunday, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday. And the meetings suddenly were canceled at the very last minute as he was getting on the plane in Dallas. The meetings were canceled, and it was too late for him to turn around. And I said, you just fly on to Montreal, and we will have you. And I'm so glad. I mean, we have been fed some amazing, amazing spiritual food, and we've grown by it. And I said, next time, I don't want him just to come for 3 days. I want him to come for a whole week again. This is too good. It's, you know, I don't care. I'm greedy. I'm just greedy for more of the Word of God. Greedy for more of the Spirit of God. More of the revelation. More of the power. More of the gifts. Hallelujah. Well, Brother Begley, here we go. It's showtime. Not a show, is it, though? It's a real deal. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Are you all turned on now?
Yes.
Are you sure?
I got you back.
Aramundi vashitara umbungida ashipando orabushitara eda mushita adama kushikamba ete. Ite praha shona mahaha. Zipaa an de banda o terra atiba o shikata banda ata.
Obtain the grace to run your race. The glory will shine out your face. You'll be a blessing to the human race. Obtain the grace, you'll find your place. The secret place, the wealthy place, the place where I can manifest my glory. For you see, grace is Jesus manifested. The work is already done. It's in the glory of his only begotten Son. So out of your belly, the grace should flow, and you be a blessing every place you go. Grace isn't limited to just one place. Grace, great grace, great grace. And in the ages to come, the ages to come, the Master will show us exceeding great grace throughout all eternity, says the Lord of hosts.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Do you need another push?
Thank you, Blasi. But this is the time.
Yeah.
For ministries to flow together.
Yes.
Yeah. Supporting one another.
Yes.
Bragging on one another.
Yes.
Holding each other up. Yay, yay, yay. One to 1,000. Two, 10,000.
Yes.
Yeah. Feisto flata, feisto vedere, Father.
For you've been gathered into this place to hear my word and receive a revelation and insight tonight that you've not had before. For there shall come light, light for you to walk in, light you've not seen before. It's not new revelation, but it'll be new to you. And so walk in the light. Walk in the revelation of what is revealed to you tonight. And you will see yourself grow. You will see yourself prosper. You will see your ministry unfold even greater, saith the Lord.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
For the end is not yet.
Yeah.
The end's not yet. Mm-hmm. We've got things to do. We've got a revival to usher in. A great transfer of wealth shall transpire.
Yes.
Great authority shall be made manifest as my body matures. The brightness of the light shall get brighter and brighter and brighter. And you shall walk in the divine. And in the gifts you'll not come behind because you're created of the God kind. So enjoy, said the Lord of hosts, and go to another dimension of the power of the Holy Ghost.
Thank you. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
But laughter does good like a medicine.
Yes.
So me and your pastor, we're on medication.
I think you've been drinking too. Except I think you've been drinking too.
How'd you know? Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Can you go sit down now?
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. The Holy Ghost shall manifest in a manner that pleases the Father. Father, I thank you for divine revelation, divine inspiration. That the words I say find lodging place in the hearts of men and women. We're looking unto you as the author and the finisher of our faith. We're an unwritten book. You started this. We think we found you, but you found us. You called us and placed the calling on each one that's here tonight. And so you started this work. You're going to finish this work. Amen. We have great confidence that you are well able to help us finish this race. Yes. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
And amen. For you folks that haven't been here this week, I'm just going to kind of pass it review for just a moment. We've been talking about, I've been on a trail here for the last 6 or 8 months on the righteousness of God. Righteousness of God is the ability to stand in His presence without feeling guilty or inferior, without any shame. There's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. The opposite of condemnation is righteousness. When you know who you are, you come bold into the throne of grace. Righteous and bold as a lion. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
We should not take a back seat to any sinner, any politician. I'm not afraid of anybody. I'm not afraid of anybody but my wife, and she ain't here. We're going to talk about, Brother Biden had a word last night, his night early, about fanning the flame. Fanning the flame. We're going to talk about an inward desire. Everybody say desire.
Desire.
Say it again.
Desire.
Say it one more time.
Desire.
His desire is for you to catch on fire and come up higher.
Yes.
So tonight we're going to locate exactly where to start with God. In Genesis, you'll find that Eve saw the tree as desire to be wise. Temptation comes with desire. Mark 11 chapter said that whatever thing you pray for, that you desire. So desire is extremely important. Jesus was tempted at all points, yet without sin. A valid temptation must have a desire. Jesus had desires. He was tempted at all points. He never yielded to them. If you can learn to stop the wrong desire before it gets conceived. Once it's conceived, lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. When sin is finished, it brings forth death. Right. Don't let 3 or 4 days or a month or a year go by in grief or jealousy or strife. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
You've got to learn to stop it at the door.
Yes.
We should not give the devil any place. The devil has no power unless you give it to him.
Right.
Listen to me carefully. You'll never find the devil in a shoe store. He's been defeated. In so many people's eyes, they see the devil big and, honey, he's a fallen angel with no discernment.
Mm-hmm.
He's a loser.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Yep.
I said he's a loser.
Yes.
He don't know what's going on. He stirred up trouble around Jerusalem, killed all those babies, and missed the right one.
Uh-huh.
Anytime you think you can overcome God, you got to be stupid.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Work with me, people. Don't make me come out there. And so, in Psalms 37:4, put that on the screen for you. 37:4. Delight.
Yeah.
Delight. The word delight means to be soft, to be sensitive, to allow joy to flow out of you. You have to choose at times to be joyous.
Yes.
Faith is a choice. Joy is a choice. Patience is a joy.
Yes.
Brother Begley, I just can't get rid of all this care. You lying heifer. Yes, you can. Bible says you can. This is my last night. I'm going to hit you and run. The Bible says cast all your care over on the Lord.
Yes.
Care allows the enemy to get permission from you to bring trouble.
Yes.
If you'll cast all your care over on the Lord, he cares for you. You can tie the hands of Satan. He can't get to you. He's got to have your permission. Any area of your life, you have to give him permission. Sometimes people do it through ignorance. They don't understand. But he can't do anything unless you give him permission. Learn to stop him at the door. Don't let it conceive and then bring forward. Stop him at the door. It always starts with a desire. I've said it night after night. There's only two kind of pie I like, hot and cold. I have no desire to eat a cow pie. Y'all know what a cow pie is? I spoke home in Texas. We have cow pies, but we have cow. I have no desire. You can't tempt me with a cow pie. I'm not interested in stealing, bribing, adultery. I'm just not interested.
Mm-hmm.
I have a greater desire to serve God
mm-hmm.
than a lower desire to serve something else.
Mm-hmm.
The devil, all he has is the lust of the eyes. And when you say lust, oftentimes you think it has some connotation of sexual. Lust just means desire.
Right. Yeah.
Lust of the eyes, pride of life, lust of the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Those desires can be stopped. Sometimes Paul said, I spank my body and keep it under.
Mm.
Some of y'all just did a good spanking. Delight thyself in the Lord, and he shall give thee what?
The desires
of God. Now, if you don't interpret this right, you say, well, he'll give you a better car, and he'll give you a better house, and he will do that. But actually, what he's talking about here, he'll give you the right desires.
Yes.
Well, if I get saved, God might send me to Africa. If he did, you'd be the happiest person in the world in Africa because he gives you the right desire.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Delight means to make one happy, to make you happy. You see, I've been content years ago, staying at home, riding my horse, shooting my gun, and yodeling. I'm from the South. You may laugh about us Southern folk, but nobody retires and moves up north. If you'll allow me, I'm going to take the word of God and dissect you. I'm going to cut you up. Proper interpretation of the Bible is paramount. The word has to be rightly divided. Else you can make the word say anything. You can say, for example, you know, Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Well, God's no respect of persons. So if he had 700 wives, 300 concubines, so can I. Dear God in heaven, what would I do with them? I have to run and cheat this evil one. No, you have to rightly divide And see, the prophet's message will be different from the evangelist. The evangelist will be different from the pastor. And good evangelists, we never die, we just turn out the pastor. The right desire is paramount. Fan the flame. If spiritual things begin to get dull and boring, it ain't God's fault. It's you. Stir up the gift of God. Stir it up. Fan the flame of that desire. Now, go with me to Thessalonians 5:23. I can quote you if I would choose it. Thessalonians 5:23. You are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. At the point of conversion, when you got born again, God took out your old human spirit and gave you a brand new spirit. That spirit is the spirit of Christ. It is holy, it is righteous, and it is sealed. You have new nature, it's holy, righteous, and sealed. Colossians chapter 3 says, if ye then be risen, one third of you is already there. One third of you is already risen. Wow. He didn't say if ye be a raisin. Work with me, people. If ye then be risen. When Christ died, you died. When he rose, you rose.
Yeah.
Yes.
Huh? Yeah. You don't, I don't want to know you after the flesh. I don't want to see you without your teeth. I don't want to see you in that house coat that needs to be burned. I like to love people long distance. See, pastor, I come in to start trouble, but pastors have to live with you. So in Thessalonians 5:23, he said, I pray God sanctify, God if he sanctify you wholly, three whole parts, spirit, soul, and body, whole spirit, whole soul, whole body, be preserved blameless to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. God right now sees you in your spirit, holy, blameless, without fault.
Yes.
Amen. Now your soul and your body, well, it needs work. That's your job.
Yes.
Your soul, the saving of the soul is a process.
Yes.
The saving of the soul is a process.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to understand, look what's coming next. Next verse, please. Faithful is he that calls you, also he will do it.
Amen.
God is committed for what he started in you to finish what's in you. He is coming. He won't leave you alone. You get off track, he'll urge you and deal with you. He's trying to get you right back on track. He is faithful. He is committed to make sure you make it to heaven.
Yes.
Yes. That ought to make a Baptist shout. He will cause you to be holy, spirit, soul, and body. Hebrews 12:2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. If you keep your eyes on Jesus, what's in your spirit is a finished work. What's in your spirit is a finished work. Finished from the foundation of the world. He made you righteous, sanctified, wisdom, redeemed, atonement, paid for in full. You've got a belly full of God. Let him leak out. Let it bleed through to the other parts of you. Huh? The Bible says, don't quench the Spirit. The Spirit's trying to navigate and operate in the other two parts of you. You can come to a place where you even, it's just like working out. When you're not in shape, you're not working out, you're like, dear God, I got to go and work out. And your body will think, just 5 more minutes of sleep.
Yeah.
5 more minutes ain't going to help you.
Nope.
But once you train the body, after a while, it'll start liking it. And look forward to it.
Yes.
Huh? See, once you train the body, the Bible says mortify. Mortify means to set to death.
Yes.
Make it stay there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't do brickwork, but I watch it on TV. Once you set the brick and it dries, the mortar, it stays there.
Mm-hmm.
Tell your body what to do. No more Krispy Kreme. I'm going to preach over here. So faithful he that calls you, he also will do it. Now go to Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12. I had to quote this one on you see. Hebrews 4 12. For the word of God is alive. Sharper. A two-edged sword. Piercing. Dividing asunder. The spirit, the soul, the joints of our. Why do you need to divide the word? And why does the word need to divide you? You need to learn to let the word divide you.
Yes.
You need to learn that the word divides you. You need to learn that the word divides you. The real you is your spirit. The real you is your spirit. If you focus on your spirit and the finished work of Christ, then when you mess up in your soul or your body, you won't get down and disgusted and condemned. You'll just repent, get right back up and take off.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
I've seen people that would grieve for years of something that's going through. One lady, bless her darn heart and empty head, still wanted a revival, and she come up and she's crying. Crocodile tears. I said, sister, calm down. God is still on the throne. She said, I lost Fluffy. I said, what? I lost Fluffy. I said, who's Fluffy? My cat. I said, sister, when did this happen? She said, been 2 years, it's October. I said, sister, go to the stove and get you another cat. You should not let anything have that much attachment that 2 years later you're grieving for a cat. You shouldn't give anything that much place in your life except Christ. Huh? I know you may not like my type of preaching. I really don't care. I'm leaving town. But people do some of the dumbest things. They're driving down the road. Driving down the road. Here comes a deer. They'll pull off, hit a tree, and kill two of their family members. Yeah. Hit the deer. God can make another deer. It's amazing. So, why do you need the word to divide us? You need to understand your soul and your body is not generated or regenerated. The only part of you that changes a new birth is your spirit. Yeah. Now, when the trump sounds, trust me, the flesh cannot be saved. Will never be saved. It has to be changed. Yeah. Right. Amen. The Bible calls it a vile body. Mm-hmm. So the body still has a wrong nature, the attributes of the old nature. Yes. In the new birth, God took out your old sinful nature and put in his nature. You are a success if you just learn to yield and make a decision out of his nature. Yes. But it starts with a desire. Everybody say desire.
Desire.
Desire is a funny thing. It can be very small, but if you fan it and fan it and fan it, it'll grow and it can actually dominate your life. There are people that never was interested in motorcycles. And somebody come along and they get a motorcycle. And before you know it, they're wearing leather. They're tattooed. They done pierced everything they got. Huh? They yielded to that desire. That desire began to grow. Let us desire to seek the face of God, yes, till the glory flows out of us. Yes. Now you walk into Walmart, 9 people fall out in the power.
Yes, sir.
I thought that was good. Dividing the soul, the spirit, the joints of the heart. Discerning the thought, and the intent are the desires of the heart. God understands you have good intention. But if you don't fan that, people say, Pastor, I'm going to start coming to your church. Well, don't hold your breath.
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh? They'll go to a fasting church and say, Pastor, I'll do anything you want me to do. And next Sunday you can't even find them. Right. See, they had a desire, but they didn't fan it and flame and let it grow until it drove them through passion to do what they should do.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
That's called lukewarm. I mean, a lot of Christians, they're lukewarm. I call them looky pooky. Not to their face. But God said, if you're lukewarm, here you go. God wants you. How do you stay hot? By fanning the flame of desire to where it doesn't matter what comes or goes, your desire carries you through life. Now, my first missionary trip, I think I was 17 years old, went to Mexico. I went down there, folks. I'm going to tell you, I listened to some faith tapes. I went down. Can I get Pentecostal? I went down to old Mexico. And I'm telling you, I went to this church. I know they had bars on the window. I thought, I wonder why they got bars on the window. Well, wasn't very long. I found out why. They were crazy people.
Yes.
Insane people come jump on the bars.
Yes.
Oh, really?
Like a gorilla. All I can do is throw a tape at him. See, a lot of people think they're real. teaching.
Yeah.
In school, a test shows you what you know. Mm. And those Christians fold up like a cheap chair. Somebody said something bad about me. Well, that's partially true. I got a word for you. Suck it up, buttercup. Get your feelings off your sleeve. Be the master of your emotion. Be the master of your body. If you're going to ever do what God called you, you have to be temperate and control your body, control your mouth, control your actions, control your money.
Yes.
I just don't like you, Brother Dale. Blame him. He let me go. He said, beware in the last days, for thou heap together teacher, having itching ears. That means certain groups will only have certain people to tell them what they want to hear.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not for hire.
Mm.
Huh? I'm not for hire.
Right.
I'm not going to prostitute my gift.
No. No. No.
I can hear y'all groaning in the spirit. Go to Philippians 2 and 12. It, with this in mind, that you need to learn to divide yourself. As you go to Philippians 2 and 9, I'm going to coach you another scripture. Everybody knows Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a brand new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things come new. Everybody knows that.
Yeah.
And another person don't know that. But the verse up above that is extremely important. Verse 16. It says this: I don't know anybody anymore after the flesh. I knew Jesus, but I don't know him after the flesh. You don't need to know anybody after the flesh. You don't even need to know yourself after the flesh. Your identity is not in your flesh. Your identity is in your spirit.
Amen.
I am crucified with him. I can do all things through him. Whatever you focus on, you'll gravitate to.
Yes.
If you focus on your shortcomings and your failures, your testimony is, I'm just an old sinner, saved by grace. Y'all pray real hard, please pray hard. Devil been after me all day. He ain't after you, he got you. Paul was so confident in the new birth, he should have said, I've wronged nobody. I've wronged no man. His own testimony, he probably thought the first rock to kill Stephen. The Sanhedrin court, cold-blooded murder. Huh? He got the gall. Stephen said, I've wronged nobody. How can he say that? Because he was identifying with the finished work in his spirit, not the work in progress of his soul and body. See, we're not what we used to be. We're not what we're going to be. We're way, way, long, far off from what we used to be. We're in a transitory state. We're in the process. I said to you, I am saved, being saved, will be saved. My spirit's already saved, my soul's being saved, and my body will be glorified one day and be saved.
Amen.
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 Woo! Interpretation.
Woo!
It's Philippians 2 and 12. 2 and 12. I'm sorry, 2 and 12. 2 and 12. He says, 2 and 12. Philippians 2 and 12. He said, come to pass. Wherefore, as you not always obeyed, not in my presence. You know, I've been to ministry 53 years, so y'all don't scare me. And but I've been around Christians all the time, and they're only Christians when they're around church.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. I like to tease my daughter. She lives in Cartersville, Georgia, just north of Atlanta. When I go down there, so now we've got a Cracker Barrel. Now we sitting down at the Cracker Barrel, they'll bring the food. My daughter just kind of had her head. But if they can cuss him, why can't we praise him?
Yes.
See, I preached about the fifth gospel, Romans 1:17. Said, I'm not ashamed. See, when you come up against something that counters what you believe, you ought to counter it.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Huh? Yeah. I'm not ashamed to tell a Catholic. Ain't no use you praying to the Pope. Huh? Yeah. Ain't no use you praying to Mary. Now, Mary's a good woman. She'd help you if she could, but she did. But Jesus is alive.
Yeah.
You wasting your time praying to Mary.
Yeah.
Huh? It's amazing. 7 dead minutes. It's not a day, it's a person.
Right.
The Sabbath is a person.
Yeah.
Other group, water baptism. Water won't save you. But then you get saved every time it rained.
Yeah.
So you should counter unbelief. Because, listen, unbelief tolerated is faith contaminated. When you put up with a little unbelief, it won't be long, your faith will go. So I met Brother Sarmaugh a couple of times, and I've been on his TV show a couple of times. I've met his son, and Brother Botany had him in his church. And I said, Lord, one time, because I was in a meeting, and I said, Lord, I'd like to meet Brother Sarmaugh. And I was driving through McAllister, and the Lord said, turn in. He's at that restaurant. I walked out, and there he was. Wow. Well, now a few years later, he came on to Living Word Church, where my pastor is, and I was behind him. And we walked down the aisle there. He walked by a lady, and let's say she was between 500 and 1,000 pounds. She was Sister Fluffy. He walks by, said, lose 100 pounds, you'll feel better. He just walked out of the door. Now listen, so I said, why would somebody be so gruff? Why would Smith women be so gruff? Righteous people can be bold without being rude. Mm-hmm. But this is what he said. Sometimes it's like a dog. You don't say, Puddles, go back to the house. Go on, Puddles. Yeah! A dog can tell what mood you're in. The devil knows if you mean it. I said, the devil knows if you mean it. I'm down in Louisiana when I was about 22 years old, 21, 22. And I didn't know sickle would come here. I mean, I've been raised Pentecostal, but all we knew was thank God for things. Oh, please. Oh, God. I don't have any Pentecostal. Hey, God. Hey, God. And so, I'm making fun. And so, I was this church, and I get through preaching, and while I'm preaching, this lady comes up and gets on the floor and starts wiggling like a snake and said, I'm a snake. I'm a snake. Well, you know, I'm in Cajun country. She could be a snake. I don't know. Well, anyway, she got to hissing, and spitting on the boots. Well, it's kind of embarrassing. I don't know what to do. I'm only 21 years old. So finally, I just go over and let her hiss a while, sat on the altar, and I folded my hands. Just like that. Well, the night before, in this dream, I chased this little monkey-looking demon all night long. And about daylight, I grabbed my neck and poof, the thing exploded. Mm-hmm. I said, yeah, Lord trying to tell me something. It's a sad day when they have to put you to sleep to talk to you. But I'm just getting started, I don't know. And so I stood up, I said, you foul devil, help come out in Jesus' name. God desnectatized her. She become the organ player in the church. She did. I said, she did. But while I sat on the altar, wonderful, kind, loving believers walked up there and rubbed the Bible on her. Folks, it's just paper and ink until it gets in your heart and comes out your mouth. There was a lady in Kansas not too far from where Brother Mark pastored, and she ground her Bible up and put it in her oatmeal and ate the Bible. Don't you know that God was impressed because she ate the word with her oatmeal? See, you didn't let the Bible say anything. Mm-hmm. You have to be rightly divided then, you have to rightly divide you. There's certain scriptures talking directly to your spirit. There's other scriptures talking directly to your soul. Other scriptures talking directly to your body. And if you don't learn that, you'll get confused. For example, Romans chapter 12. He said, I beg you that you, your spirit, present your body. You, your spirit, present your body and living sacrifice by transmuting and renewing your mind. There's spirit, soul, and body. You've got to learn to divide the word and let the word divide you. Huh? I'm not pure and holy and righteous in my flesh. You have two organs in your body that smells. Your feet and your nose. You're not perfect in your flesh. You're not perfect in your flesh. You're not perfect in your soul. We still make mistakes. But you shouldn't camp there, spend 6 months there, come up with a song, gloom, despair, agony, homie. You just don't know what I'm going through. You just don't know what they said about me. Well, they don't determine who you are. This determines who you are. What God says about you. Huh? No weapon formed against me shall prosper. So I say what he said. He said that we are the apple of his eye.
Amen.
Huh? Amen. Go ahead and smile. Your false teeth are whole. Go ahead and smile. Father's going to do a job. He said, work out your own salvation. You were fear and trembling. Trembling here is an expression of you ought to be cautious. You don't want to be in something God don't want you. If you try to do everything, you'll mess up who you are.
Yes, sir.
Trust me, there's churches that pay me not to sing. Next verse, please. For it is God which worketh in you both to will. What's it done? To will. That's your desire. He's working on your desire for his desire and your desire to match up.
Yes.
Amen. That's what he's doing. Because if he's got your heart, he's got your billfold.
Yes, sir.
Come on, somebody. He's got your heart. See, God looks at the heart. He don't monitor your soul and body like we do. Man looks on the outside. But God looks at the heart. My neighbor, a few years ago, during my cowboy days, my neighbor had a Palomino stallion. It's worth $100,000. And I had a couple of mares, you know, and he gonna breed them for me. And then I had another horse, and it was black, and he said, Maggie, you gonna sell that horse? I said, well, I don't like that horse. He said, well, I can sell it for you. He said, I have papers that will fit that. Whoa. I said, well, but it's not a quarter horse. Yeah, but I have papers that will fit that horse. And you'll make more money. I said, but, he said, nobody will know. I said, well, but I will. So, they found him dead about a year and a half later in his living room, and the only hope I got is he saw Christ in me. Because he cussed the man he taught sailors how to cuss.
Yeah.
But he saw integrity.
Mm-hmm.
He saw, are you listening to me?
Because
the Bible says you are an epistle.
Yeah.
Not just a pistol, you're an epistle.
Yeah.
Men of all men, so somebody's watching you. So it's not just in the church, oh, how I love Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus. That's all right, but do you?
Yeah.
You can't love Jesus without loving people.
That's right.
You can't, that's the measure of how much you love Jesus.
Come on,
yes. You want to go somewhere? You want to go somewhere?
Yeah.
I can tell exactly how much you love God, the way you treat me.
Because
I'm his favorite. You can't mistreat people.
That's right.
See, we're too prone to judge something. Well, if we're not up on, we're down on. But you need to learn to divide your spirit, soul, and body. So if you make a mistake, you fall short. Hebrews says, don't let it slip. Don't neglect it. Don't come short of it. Well, oftentimes we do. How many here has said, I'm not going to do that again as long as I live? 2 hours later, you done it again.
Yeah.
It's You get frustrated with yourself.
Yeah.
But what you need to learn to do is relax and trust the grace in you to do it.
Right.
Time and time again, Paul said, when I'm weak in myself, this is when I tap into his grace. It ain't me, it's the grace. He said, I labored more, I did more, I got beat up more, but it wasn't me, it was the grace. I don't have the grace to pastor. I put everybody's tithe record on the wall. Next time you testify, I'd take your tithe record. I say, liar, liar, kind of don't fire, liar. Don't mess with me. I'm leaving town. But I have the grace to travel. Huh? It don't mean I don't get tired sometimes, but I have the grace to travel. There's some people don't have that grace. Locate your grace, find your place, or you'll fall on your face. Just the truth. That's where your grace is. Trust me, I am not a good cook. One time, I didn't realize it. You know, my wife went to visit her mother-in-law, and as a trial. Then she went to visit her mother-in-law, and so I got the kids, and I cooked some hamburger meat in the microwave. That was scary.
Oh.
I made the kids eat it, but anyway. And my wife, she taught my daughter how to clean house. immaculate housekeeper. But she never taught her how to cook. Well, later in life, she got married and went down to her house in Georgia, and she cooked a pecan pie. The seeds of what she didn't do. See, everything you do is a seed. Everything. If you don't do anything, you'll grow a couch potato. Everything's a seed. Every word, every action is a seed. Some of them don't come up for 10, 12 years. I'm in Davenport, Iowa. I was 22 or 23. And we had revivals in that city. And it shook the whole community. I mean, it was almost a citywide revival. It's five cities there, quad cities. And 30 years later, I get a phone call from Dr. White out of Washington, D.C. He said, Brother Begley, he said, I know you probably don't remember me. He said, well, she was there in Davenport, Iowa, over Rock Island, across the river, on the meeting. And he said, somebody had put a flyer on one of our apartments there where I was going to college to become a doctor. He just only said, signs and wonders, miracles follow this man. He thought, well, I'll just give it a shot. So he comes over there to the revival. I don't remember it. He told me the story. He said, me and my wife came the first night, and you scared us so bad. We got up and left by half service. Scared us so bad. He said, I was fabulous. He said, but something in here wanted to go back. Little desire. So he went by himself. He said, next thing I know, I was in the prayer line. Next thing I know, I was on the floor talking in tongues. He said, I went home and said, honey, it's real. It's real. It's scary, but it's real. He went to touch her to lay hands on her. He said, you want it? And she started talking in tongues. He carried that anointing back. He didn't tell me. 35 years later, I get a phone call. He tells me this. He said, after you left the revival, he said, I went to work for Happy Hunters. Worked with it for 5 years. He said, I got a very large ministry. And he said, I'm also a doctor. Got a very financial, secure operation here in Washington, D.C. And he sent me $5,000. I thought, couldn't you at least wrote me a letter? So I'm in Dallas, Texas. Woman walks in. I'm in another man's meeting. She said, is that Pastor Dale? He said, Brother Dale. She said, I got healed of cancer in this tent revival in Seymour, Indiana, or Seymour, Missouri. It's amazing how God does things and people don't tell you. Mm-hmm. It would be good to tell somebody.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Huh?
I'm in Sand Springs, Oklahoma, tent revival. Get a tent revival. 25, 30 years of life goes by. A lady friend that sells dogs and part of our ministry, she's an older lady, she said, I've got a friend up in Chicago that her church didn't do very well. Would you call her and kind of encourage her? So I called this pastor lady. I said, I just want to call and encourage you. She said, are you Dale Begley? I said, yes. She said, I got healed in your meeting in Sand Springs, Oklahoma. All the way to Chicago. You're only seven people away from meeting somebody that knows somebody in the whole world. So what you do, how you act, affects people's lives.
Yes.
Huh? Give the Lord a good praise, everybody.
Hallelujah.
So it's important not to know other people after the flesh. It's important not to recognize yourself after the flesh.
Yes.
Now you know, and God knows that you make mistakes, but that's not what you should measure on.
Right.
Huh?
I just can't seem to quit smoking.
I can help you. I can help you. If you cuss, watch pornography, and smoke, I can help you. Bring me some rope and some duct tape. See, I can help you. I just constrained you. We've tried to change people's lifestyle by preaching how you should live.
Well, what's wrong with that?
Get the right liver inside you and you'll live right.
Mm-hmm.
Start yielding to Him. Still yielding your flesh all the time. Learn to spank it, mortify it, tell them what to do.
Come on.
Huh? Amen. There's times I just say, Dale, shut up.
Yeah.
I learned that from my wife. what pastor asked me, when you sometimes do you when you wake up from a sleep, are you cranky? I said, no, I just let her sleep. I don't care who you are. Your flesh gets tired, it gets cranky, because it's not totally redeemed. When the trump's out, it'll be changed. But until that time, be a good steward of your body and your soul with your spirit. Make it do what it's supposed to do. Fan the flame. Desire gets so strong, so strong, so strong, that those little temptations won't even bother you anymore. That's how Jesus did it. He did not have fallen nature, but yet he was tempted in all points. Everything he was tempted. He was tempted by the devil. Value D, I'll give you all this kingdom. He was tempted. The desire was there. He just had a greater desire to please his Father.
Amen.
Never took credit for any miracle. Never took credit for anything. Be careful thinking it's you. You're just a donkey. Give him a good ride. It was I love Brother Dale. I've been here 8 days. Could you put a little oomph in that?
Brother Dale.
Go over to Corinthians 15:10. He's working on your will by giving you the right desire. He said in Corinthians 15:10, he said, this is what he's talking about, the thorn in the flesh. Apostle Paul was very intelligent, very extremely intelligent. Most people in his day, 90% of people couldn't read. 90% of people could not read. And so he was very well schooled, very intelligent. And so it buggeth him when he preached something, they go on and tell he preached something else. He said, God forbid, I didn't preach that. I didn't say you're supposed to sin. That makes the grace of God abound. I didn't preach that. But you can't clean up messages. I have found that certain people don't like me. If they knew me, they'd like me. I know me. I like me. But usually, if they don't like a person that's the good son, they're hiding something. Yes. Something wrong somewhere. Yeah. And you can pick it up in your spirit. Yes. Huh? They don't want you to get too close. Because you find out they're stepping out on the weekend. Mm-hmm. Or they got a gambling habit or something. Well, that's between you and God. Are you listening to me? Yeah. But they know that you know. She was quiet and spoke gospel church. Can we go to Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15:10? This is Paul's thorn in the flesh. And he wanted to straighten things out, and he couldn't. He prayed 3 times. What did he say? My grace is sufficient. What does that mean? It means if you depend on the grace on the inside of you, you don't have to fix everything. God will.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah. Huh? Yes. Don't try to straighten out people.
Right.
If God can't straighten them out, you ain't got a chance.
Right.
Amen.
Learn to trust the God in you.
Yes.
I am persuaded he's able to keep that I've committed unto him against that day.
Right.
He's still working on you. Your unfinished work.
Yes. Right.
Now, some of y'all got a lot of loose ends.
Yes. Right.
But he's a miracle worker.
Yes.
Nothing too hard for God.
Yeah.
The question is looking under Jesus, the author. See, he started the book.
Yes.
You're an open book. You're an unwritten book. When I was 22 years old, I didn't know I was going to do tent ministry and do this and do that and travel and go to Africa and the Philippines and I didn't in Canada. Ooh, Canada. Ooh, it's cold up there. In Montreal. If I ever go to Montreal again, it'll be purgatory. You can't understand them talk. By grace of God, I am what I learned to depend on that grace. Grace is divine ability. It's not an agenda. It's not a curriculum. It's not just a doctor. It's a person.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
He got plenty of grace for you to do things that you don't know how to do.
Right.
If you stay hooked up with the Holy Ghost, he'll make you look good. Because
yes.
He's a genius.
Yes.
He can draw things out of there that you didn't know you had.
Yes.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
I said, huh?
Amen.
I cut my teeth on tent ministry. So I'm in Russellville, Kentucky. That's where Jesse James robbed his first bank. I figured if he could get a start there, so could I. So I got my tent there. I'm I'm God's man of power, faith and power, oh, power. I'm preaching over a little guitar box about this big. I was so proud of it, I hid it on the pulpit. And my mic cord was on so long. And that night I got to, oh, so excited, I got to preaching on holy ground. Well, I kicked my shoes off. And I get out there, and when I got off the platform, the grass is wet. I found the power, So as sharp as I am, I just laid down the microphone. Went ahead and preached. Well, the process of time, I get back on the platform, and I forget. I give an altar call. Here comes this guy, bald-headed, perspiration on his head. I forget, I grab the microphone, I'm on the platform, I'm not grounded. But he is. I lay hands, woo! To this day, he takes out the most anointed prophet that ever lived. I said, Lord, all I need is a battery and just shock people. He said, you don't need a battery. I said, now baptize you in the Holy Ghost. It's amazing. In that same revival, there's a lady come walking down the aisle, and she couldn't wear a shoe. She had everything all right. She comes up here. The Lord says, once you get up here, step on her feet with your boots. I said, not going to do it. She's not 75 years old. I ain't going to step on that old woman's feet. To my left, sitting over there, is her son. He has arms this big around. He hauls cattle with and without a truck. What's he gonna think about me stepping on his mama's feet? I heard it again, step on her feet. He said, general healing won't heal her. It's gonna take a gift to heal him. I said, Lord, 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 Lord. I closed my eyes, stepped on her feet. I heard Rosh Kissy, pop, snap, crickle. She let out a belly hoo, woo! Devil said, you've killed her. Two women had brought her up. She slung one woman that way, slung another, and said, my God, I'm healed, my God, I'm healed, my God, I'm healed. I guarantee you, I was more gladder than she was. See, the gifts look good on paper. The gifts look good on paper, but reality, brother, sometimes it puts you on the spot. You got to know who you are, what you are, confidence in him and not yourself. Huh? So, tonight, I want you to understand something. The real you, the highest part of you, is your spirit. God is a spirit. I say this over and over and over. Back before a cell phone, if I told you I was going to call you, would you go home and set by your water heater? Dishwasher?
Nope.
Can opener? No, I'm going to contact you through the phone. When God contacts you, it's through your spirit.
Yes.
I said, it's through your spirit.
Yes.
I said, it's through your spirit.
Yes.
If you're not careful, your soul will talk you out of it.
Yes, sir.
I had a pastor come to my house one time. He was passing through, and we was walking down the hall there, and the Lord said, give him $500 and tell him before you change your mind. Well, once you tell him, you got to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See, God knows you.
Yeah.
Your mind will talk you out of it.
Yeah. That's right.
Amen.
You don't know the times. I have been there. Cancer. And the Lord said, heal her stomach. I said, Jesus, let's just heal her nice and normal. You ever going to walk out in the gifts? You ever going to get out beyond yourself? You have to covet or desire the gifts earnestly. Mm-hmm. Then when they show up, you got to obey.
Yes.
It takes some stamina.
Yes.
I've been preaching for 53 years. I got stories.
Yeah.
I'm in Jasper, Indiana, and a full gospel businessman. They're all dressed up, all got ties on, very ritzy crowd. I'm the guest speaker. Well, I get through speaking. I said, there's somebody here with a TMJ in their jaw. Well, here come a nun. It's 99% Catholic in Jasper, Indiana. She comes up. The Lord said, box your jaws. I said, dear Jesus. Let's make a deal here. These richy, fancy people, they can bless our ministry. If I slap her, they ain't gonna like me. I hauled up and boxed her jaw. You can hear her jaw pop. I'll never forget the expression on her face. She went, "Well, praise the Lord." About a half a second, I thought that nun was gonna become a flying nun. So it takes courage to talk to yourself. I'm gonna say it again. When there's lack, you reach over here in the unseen realm and say, "My God meets my needs." Huh? I said, huh? When the body's trying to be sick, you reach over here and say, "Thy stripes have healed." At that particular moment, your body's sick, and at the particular moment, you have life. But we use our faith. But when it comes to you being righteous, and you mess up, and you feel like an egg-sucking dog, it takes faith to say, "I'm righteous."
Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
But you reach over in the unseen realm and say, "I'm righteous. I'm guiltless. I can stand before God. I've repented."
Praise God.
Now, I'm not going to talk about you. I'm going to talk about your kinfolks.
Come on.
Well, your kinfolks, when they sin and they do something wrong, depending on how big it is, it usually takes 2 or 3 weeks for the memory to get rid of it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't look at me so holy. Even though you repented, got washed in the blood, you're cleansed now, but your mind still remembers what you did. And so the devil reinforces that. All he's trying to do is get your focus on the two parts of you that's fallen. When you ever get over here, you say, "Mr. The devil won't tell you something. I was crucified with Christ 2,000 years ago, and no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. I don't, you know, I have the finished work." And God has made a way, a living way, if I do mess up, ain't none of your business. Nah.
Come on.
Yes, sir.
Why does the devil care if you sin? He'll teach you to sin. If you do sin, he'll make fun of you and condemn you for sinning.
Yeah.
He's the guy that talks you into it.
Yeah.
That's called double jeopardy. Because he wants you to focus on that part of you. I quoted the first verse here. "Awake unto righteousness, sin not." If you wake up to who you are in the spirit, sin will fall off of you.
There it is.
There it is right there.
It'll just fall off of you.
Mm-hmm.
Change your want to from the inside out.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know of any Christian that really loves God that's hunting a way to sin. They're hunting a way to keep from it. This is the way. Realize what he made you, who you are in Christ, what you have. You're an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ. He made you a king and a priest.
Amen. That's good.
Huh?
Yes.
To offer the sacrifice of praise. That's when you don't feel like it.
Yes.
Let's just say your mother-in-law's come to visit and bring her twin sister. That is a huge trial. Then you find out they bought a one-way ticket. They eat all your food, complain about the food. Huh? So your friend, good Lord, take them to heaven. You have to be careful, listen, not to get against people.
Yes.
People's not the problem.
That's right.
Flesh and blood's not our problem.
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
Amen.
Listen, don't be envious of someone else getting blessed. It used to bug me. Bug me. I'd go somewhere to preach and the pastor's birthday or something and the people there, they give them a round trip free ticket to Israel, all expense paid. They give me an offering, $2. The Lord saw and said, "Don't be envious of their blessing."
Mm-hmm.
See, envy is sneaky.
Yes.
Envy is sneaky. It makes you feel bad because somebody else is doing good.
Right.
You ought to learn to rejoice. You have to rejoice by faith.
Because
right. Your turns are coming.
Right.
If you'll stay faithful, he'll do the same thing for you. Right. He's no respecter of person.
That's right.
Somebody say amen. I'm a glory.
Amen.
So let me close with this. I am what I am by the grace of God. So more labor, not in vain, my labor is more abundant than all. Yet not I. Learn that phrase. Yet not I. Yet not I. The real person, the highest part of you, the part that's not completely redeemed yet, did it, not you. Now, God will not impute sin to you. Sin will cost you. It'll cost you dearly. But he's not charging you with it. Are you listening to me?
Amen.
Yes.
Sin will cost you, open the door for the enemy to come in, but God's not doing it. The wages of sin, the heat of sin will cause the problem to come. God didn't do it. The sin did it.
Yes,
that be clear.
Yes.
He's not charging sin to anybody. He done forgave the whole world.
Yes.
Yes. Exactly.
Everybody on the planet's already forgiven.
Yes.
All they got to do is come here and receive it.
Yep.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to fast 21 days?
Nope.
Pay $10,000 tithe?
Nope.
Get your hair fixed? Get a tan?
Nope.
I'm in Jamaica. There's a group of guys. And they said, you want to smoke a little marijuana? I said, see, it's all natural. It's all natural. I said, so's the hooker. All natural.
Are you?
You can't bend the rules. What part of you wants that marijuana? It ain't your spirit.
Nope.
See, learn to distinguish your spirit from the other two parts of you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you're married, the Bible says you're going to have trouble in the flesh. My wife's from Kentucky. She is doubly anointed. But she hit the lotto, honey. She got me. Anyhow, you have to learn. When she is in stressed because of something, a trial, I just give her leeway and say that, that's just flesh. Because I very seldom ever get out of sorts. But if I ever do, she'll say, that's just flesh. Learn to talk to you. That's just flesh.
Yes.
Thank it and go on.
Yes.
That's pretty good. Go to question 220. This will be my first final closing. Question 220. He said, I am crucified with Christ. Listen to me carefully. There's 15 to 20 doctrines that Paul alone preached. Nobody else preached them. Nobody else preached them. Paul preached identity, sanctification, redemption and atonement. He preached the rapture. Nobody else preached them. You can't find the rapture in any book except Thessalonians. Are you listening to me? Paul also preached finished work, identity in him. He never met Jesus in the natural. Yet he said, I was crucified with him. Romans 6 chapter says it, knowing this. Anytime the Bible says know this, guess what? You need to know this.
Yes.
Huh?
Yeah.
Isn't this deep?
Yes.
Knowing this, that our old man, that's not your husband, not your daddy, your old man was crucified with Christ. The way God freed us from sin, the way he freed us, is he took sin nature out of us. 48 times in the book of Romans, the word sin is sin nature, not sin action.
That's right.
Sin nature. So a carnal Christian that sins often gets in trouble in their flesh. The more you mature, the less you sin.
There it is.
If you're not a better Christian today than you was last year, you need to be dedicated. Because see, God's working on you. Get closer and closer and closer. He is well able to keep that. I've committed. He is finishing your work. He's working in you. He's taking you somewhere.
Huh?
Now there's bumps on the road.
Yes.
Sometimes you blow it big time.
Yes.
Get back up.
Mm-hmm.
Take a fresh blood bath.
Mm-hmm.
Get right back in there.
Yes.
He did not demand perfection from you.
Right.
He came down and walked a perfect life.
Amen.
And gave you his perfection.
There it is.
If the world only knew what we have, they'd put down their cocktails and their cigars and their gambling and come to church.
Right.
We got the best product in the world. We're just not presenting it right.
Yeah.
If they ever find out, who wouldn't want to be an heir of God? Who wouldn't want to be a joint heir with Jesus? Who wouldn't want to be live in heaven forever? Huh? So their desires of chasing life, low-level life, cancels out the desire chasing the highlight.
Yes.
It's all about your desires.
Yes.
I'm closing. I apologize. I'm keeping some of y'all awake. Paul the Apostle.
That's good preaching.
Zeal. Full of zeal. Desire to squash this rebellion. Met Jesus and turned his desires completely around.
Yes.
And you couldn't stop the man.
Right.
You couldn't. You could beat him up, stone him, throw him in jail. Still couldn't stop him.
Yes.
John the Revelator. Yes. They beat him.
Yes.
Tried to boil him at all. And just couldn't kill him. Couldn't stop him.
Right.
Be more than a conqueror. Unstoppable.
Yes.
Unmovable. Yes. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. Because knowing your labor is not in vain.
Amen.
One more scripture. One of my favorite. Psalm 127. I'm quoting. Except God build the house. They labor in vain that build it. Notice they built it. Notice they built it. The Lord said to me, they've learned to have church without me.
Yes.
Look at human effort. Human effort tried to get to heaven through the Tower of Babel.
Yes.
Human effort tried to create a golden calf god.
Mm-hmm.
Human effort takes the place of Christianity.
Yeah.
It's called religion.
Yeah.
It's not about you. It's all about him and what he did.
Yes.
The reason you get the benefits is because you're in union with him.
Yes.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
My desire, I'm 70, I look 60, Act 50, wish I was 30. But I'm going to finish my race strong.
Amen.
Brother Mike is going to finish his race strong.
Yes.
If the Lord tarries at 95, you're going to see Paul Begley coming to town. They ain't no quit. They ain't no quit. They ain't no quit. I've been shot at, almost thrown in jail. That's on a good day. Get a half hour more minutes.
Yeah.
See, folks, I cut my teeth in tent ministry. I did 17 years. I wore up 5 tents. I cut my teeth outside in the real world, not behind Christian walls.
Yes.
Right. Huh?
Yes.
So I'm in Scottsburg, Indiana. I'm preaching every night at 8 o'clock. Car come by and cuss me. Stupid. Why would you cuss a man got a microphone? I'm getting louder than you. Third or fourth night.
There you go.
The car stopped. They cussed me once again. Car stopped. Back door swung open. Lady come running out of there. Come to the altar and got saved.
Oh.
To the testify. She said, I am a prostitute from Louisville, Kentucky. These men have hired me for the week.
Oh, wow.
But something got a hold of me. I couldn't take it any longer. Came in, got saved, baptized in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
There you go.
I'm in Joplin, Missouri, under my tent. One of my workers, I had, I think, 5 workers at that time. He said, Brother Dale said, this guy says he's going to kill you. I said, bring him here. He wasn't big. Bring him here. So he brought him up here. This church is over. And the Lord said, pick him up. Took these hands, grabbed him by the shoulder. Something came on me, the anointing of Samson. I picked him up and held him in the air. Feet just dangled. The Lord said, throw him down. I said, my pleasure. I throw him down. Time he hit the floor, he's saved talking in tongues. He's a backslidden preacher. And he was mad because I was still preaching. Oh, God's got a way, honey. God's got a way. Now, I can tell you 100 stories tonight. Time and time again. He's faithful.
Yes.
He's not through working on you.
Right.
And so really, all these years, he's trained me to come to Fredericton to straighten y'all out. You know God has a sense of humor?
Yes.
You know Jesus had one-liners? He did. Gag a gnat and swallow a camel. Kids like to be around him.
Yes.
His strongest anointing wasn't healing. Is the oil of gladness.
Yes.
Joy.
Yeah.
Joy. If you're not enjoying the journey, You're not doing it right. Give the Lord one more shout, everybody.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory. Tonight, the anointing manifestation, if you need prayer, we're going to lay hands on you and enhance your desire. We're going to stir up the gift. Paul said, I long to see you that I may impart to you some spiritual gift, to the end you might be established. You know, Timothy said, he said, stir up the gift that you receive by putting on of hand. There's something about transference. There's something about the anointing being transferred that stirs up someone's spirit. So if you're here tonight and you need something else, you need a financial, or you need healing, all you need to do is come in line. We're going to lay hands on you, and in Jesus' name, the same anointing that will stir up the anointing will heal your body. Amen. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Don't make me sing you a song. Oh, I got one. If you believe it, you will get it. If you don't want it, you won't want it. My country version. If you believe it, you will get it. If you don't want it, you won't want it. You need prayer. Y'all come on in. We need prayer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, just make a line of you in Jesus' name. But there's no other name powerful than that. Brother Mark, would you come up here and stand beside me? She's tough. Like that. Depends on how deep I go. She will sometimes I didn't get ever had. We talked this morning on songs and hymns and spiritual songs. We talked on groaning in deeper into the very few people go very deep in the Holy Ghost. It's like water. Water's deep. Deep calleth the deep. Pasi kipaha. Rofo pasi kingine. Lama mamaha. Let me hit it. Ningon so bringing gong granite goes about you should hear it. Holy shit. Focus, focus. Don't just wonder, see who's in the prayer line. You focus on you getting yours. You focus on you receiving. And when I touch hands or lay hands on you, believe you receive. Believe, I don't care if you don't feel anything. I don't care if you follow the power. Just believe you receive. I'm going to go deeper. Masakite pepe. Mando. Esto. Frando. Siko. Frasas. Engon sin engon safaga. Branda mama mashekete. Roshike brava baha. Brother Biden, come up here and stand by the pulpit, if you will. I need your anointing to help me. Masakite. Here comes. Meshi propatike. Meshi propakite. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, receive. Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Ha. In Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Oh, shiki, pa. In Jesus' name, receive. Mon shiki, pa, pa, pa. In Jesus' name, receive. Take it off, sister. You need it. Take it off. In Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Woo! Oh, it's going all over you. That power's going all over you. In Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Woo! In Jesus' name, receive. 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 Ah! In Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Ha ha ha. Panisha. 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 In Jesus' name, receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Shoo! Oh. In Jesus' name, receive! Jesus' name, receive! Every power of the devil broken off your life, receive in Jesus' name. If there's any more, step up in front of these other people. If there's any more, come out in front of them. I done got you once. Get you again. In Jesus' name. Receive. In Jesus' name, receive. Your knees are being healed. Your knees are being healed. Do I know you? I know you, don't I? You're from Keith. Where you from? You're from here? There's something about you. Your desire for God is extremely strong. In Jesus' name, you will be what He's called you to be. You will do what He's called you to do. In Jesus' name, the mantle of the Holy Ghost be upon you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Receive. Receive in Jesus' name. You ready? In Jesus' name, receive. Whew. You need another dose of the Holy Ghost. God's healing your body. Your stomach is a mess. Your intestines is a mess. In Jesus' name, you're healed. That's what you came for. It's what you got. In Jesus' name. Isn't God good?
God is wonderful. Hallelujah.
Someone else need prayer real quickly? She will shut up on silly pity. Will shut up on silly bone silly pity. In Jesus' name, receive. Receive in Jesus' name. You'll laugh for 30 days. Glory. Thank you. That gets you to. In Jesus' name, receive. 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 Shut everybody else out. And focus. Jesus' name, reach 30, 30, 30. There's the healing power. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory. Lois, a fresh anointing is coming on you. Your hands will tingle. Your mouth shall quiver. Words will come out of your mouth that you didn't know you had. You'll start prophesying and running. You'll start speaking and decreeing things and squashing come to pass. This is a new season for you. You're stepping into another level. Another level. So get ready. There'll be persecution. They'll make fun of it and say she's just putting on a show. But you go with the real. You go with the real. Because the Lord's going to demonstrate and display His power through your hands in Jesus. The best is yet to come. The story of water into wine. Of fire to your life. Whatever He tells you to do, you do that. And you'll see a manifestation of the glory of God. Thank you. Glory. Yes. You need something, sister? What do you need? Lift your hands. If you're in the house or not, you have any trouble with fear, won't you stand your feet? Any trouble with fear. Depression, anxiety, frustration, any type of fear. Fear is a tormenting spirit. It has no right to torment you. In the name of Jesus, on the authority, I speak and decree a thing. The spirit of fear, leave these people. Leave them now in Jesus' name. They'll never fear another day in their life. They'll have total confidence in the Father God that loves them. They cast out all fear in Jesus' name. Now go ahead and dance like you got it. 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 You know, when I was younger and wasn't living like I should all together, if you ever went to a dance, nobody was embarrassed to dance. They'd do the funky chicken. Huh? They look like fire ants in their britches. They'd get a little tipsy and wouldn't care what anybody thought. But see, that's a kind of, that's a copy of what God had. That's a counterfeit.
Yes.
We should be tipsy.
Amen.
If you're really full and stay full, you ought to be half drunk.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
All the time when I get out of the anointing, I can't even get my words out. I have to get back out of the spirit, slow down a little bit, get my words out. Because it has an effect on you. He said, don't be drunk with wine. Don't be drunk with wine. Be drunk in the spirit.
There you go. Yeah.
Folks, listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. People pay $50 to $100 to $200 for a pill that gives them a little buzz.
Yeah.
And I stay buzzed all the time.
Yes, sir. Praise God.
In Captain Coleman's ministry, they'd be sitting there 2 hours. And she'd walk out wearing a chiffon dress and say, are y'all waiting for me? You think, what premise is she on? Heaven. It's okay to dance. It's okay to drink. Just change fountains.
There you go. That's it. That's it. That's
I don't know if you know this or not, but the world is going heavy towards drugs.
Yes. Oh, yes.
There's no answers there.
Right.
No. We have the right drug. Angel dust. We have the right drug. Do you need prayer, brother? You've tied the first? You make me look good. Father, in Jesus' name, grant desires of his heart. In Jesus' name, you can count it done. You can count it done. That's the power. That's the power. That's the power. Well, ain't God good?
It is wonderful.
Just to loosen y'all up a little bit, Brother Hagin used to say this, if we lead people in singing, we also lead people in laughter. The scripture.
Yes.
Song in my mouth, laughter in my tongue. The same tongue as speaking tongues ought to laugh.
Yes.
Laughter is the only exercise your liver ever gets. So you need to exercise your liver because it's getting fat. It puts endorphins in your body, and a merry heart does good like a medicine. The reason I use laughter as a tool, it opens the spirit up. You ever try to tell something to someone who's mad?
Yes.
You can't tell a mad woman anything. Just give her the credit card and let her go. You can't. But if you get someone laughing, it opens your spirit up. Do you know laughter's contagious? You know the devil never laughs? If he ever does laugh, it's counterfeit.
That's right.
The Bible says he who sits in the heavens laughs. God is a laughter. He looks down at the devil's strategy and says, ha, 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 look what he's trying to do. He can't do that. He laughs at his strategy. So you ought to laugh at famine, laugh at destruction.
Amen. Amen.
It's scientific proof at the Mayo Clinic. People have laughed themselves well.
Yes.
Laughed themselves well.
Yeah.
People who should have died laughed themselves well.
Yes, sir.
Laugh it's God happy. Good.
Yes, sir.
I said, it's God good.
Amen. Yes.
The world is looking for what we have.
Yes.
We can get drunk. We can take trips without even leaving the farm.
There you go. Hallelujah. No side effects. Harmful side effects. Yeah.
I got to meet Jesse DeFantis a month ago, and he's known as the Apostle of Joy. And well, if you don't know, when we was younger, we preached in the same churches together. Not together, but he'd preach one revival, and I'd come on to preach the same revival in the same church. And they thought I copied him. I thought he copied me. Now, we don't need a house full of Jessies. You don't need a house full of Begleys. But you need to be you.
Amen.
Huh? Amen. I said, huh?
That's it, yeah.
And so, let your light shine, find your grace, walk in your place. You'll be a blessing to the human race. Give the Lord praise, everybody.
Hallelujah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, he wants you to come up for a minute. Would y'all mind coming? Pastor, you got it, you come.
No, just let him stand up there a little bit with you. That'll get on
him. Okay.
Not all over me.
God, all over you. Sister, you stand right here, please. Brother, just stand here. You are very unique. Some would even say peculiar. But don't let anything take your starch. Don't let persecution. I've had people make fun of me and, call me different things, and it tries to hinder your flesh. But don't let flesh slow you down. What you guys have is very, very precious.
Yes.
You don't find it everywhere you go. And so I'm going to prophesy to you for this next year. Past October, September, December, January the 3rd, you'll see a shift in your ministry. In that shifting, you'll seem like you just live under an open heaven. And favor will come on you in such a way, people just walk up to you, meet you on the street, and hand you money. Others walk up to you and say, is there anything I can do for you? He's going to join two new partners that will be faithful. You'll be able to come and go as you please. The struggle for finances will be over. No more struggling into this year, in the first of next year. No more struggling, says the Lord. I will give you a dream, and in this dream, it will give you details on how you should respond, and I'll make you wealthy as you win souls for the kingdom, says the Lord.
Praise God.
Now, you could do a whole much more if you had, 10, 15, 20 million. And so, God has this in reserve. And it'll start flowing to you in this year, begin the first year. When it starts flowing, you'll notice persecutions kick up. More persecution. And they'll start pointing the finger. But that's the time to look inside to the finished work and say, Christ, my desire is not money. My desire is to build the kingdom and further your work. And you'll see this manifest because the Lord spoke it, we decreed it, and it shall come to pass, said the Lord of hosts. Well, glory. Let me take those of your hands. The anointing of the Holy Ghost that's on me, come on them. And the anointing on them, come on me. In Jesus' name. Father, we are sold out. We're sold out for you. 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 We are sold out for you. Anything, anywhere, anytime, we belong to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. You can count it done in Jesus' name. We'll give them a hand clap.
Amen.
They are wise people coming to church. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
God, you're good.
Thank you, Lord. I know you people have gave. And we received this morning's offering for us, for me and my family's expenses. But I want to donate what y'all give tonight back to the ministry. I want the ministry to go further, faster, and reach more people. I don't know if you know this or not, but the older you get, the quicker time goes by.
Yeah.
I don't even know where this year is going to. It just, I don't know where we're at on the numbers, on the budget. I don't even know, don't even really care. I just want to say, whatever you do tonight will help us go further and faster. I don't tell everybody this. I feel like I can't hear. I pay churches off. Just the other day, one of our partners was buying. I paid his house payment. I paid the person's funeral. It's not mine. I just handle it.
Yes. Yes.
We're just stewards.
Yes. Amen.
Huh? When 5 years ago, I met you here, Tim.
College.
How long ago was that?
Wow, 2010.
2010. First time I met him, we gave $100 and a watch. I met him today, gave him $100 and a watch. He must like watches. Don't worry, it wasn't a Rolex. But here's the thing. Become a giver. Wherever you go. My wife can't hardly be in a ghost store. And the person that can't pay with it, she'll pay for it. She just did that yesterday. It just thrills Phil. They can't figure out what you're doing. She's donated 13 years to our local nursing home. 13 years. We have spent hundreds, even thousands of dollars helping old people. Well, they can't pay you back. Well, she's there. So when they get ready to pass over, she'll say, you know, are you ready? One just passed away yesterday. She helped get him ready to go. Oh. Isn't that pure religion? Huh? Helping people that can't pay you back? The fatherless, the widows? Sad to say, in my community, no church comes to that nursing home.
Oh, I know.
But we do. We've been there. We're going to stay there. You, just a smile on their face when you bring them ice cream. Or a popsicle. You think that you hung the moon. If you just give them 2 minutes of your time, they go, oh. You make them feel so important. What is life all about if we can't help people?
That's right, amen.
And so what y'all give tonight to the ministry is going to go towards the nursing home and help us go further and faster for the kingdom of God. Is that all right to everybody?
Amen. Amen.
Amen. I got 3 amens.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I don't know how to tell you this. Just sit there. Pastor Biden gave $10,000 this week. Sister Nelly gave $5,000. You watch. They'll be the ones that start getting whopper chunk income.
Amen.
You gotta break the sound barrier.
Amen.
If you want to fly.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. It wasn't until I gave huge that I broke it. I have no needs. I'll never have another want as long as I live.
Mm-hmm.
I'll never struggle financially. How can you say that? Like this, I'll never struggle financially.
Amen.
It's coming in on every way.
Amen.
If you don't do what God tells you, you're just cheating yourself. You ain't cheating me. Because God will get it to me some other way.
Yes.
If a cow bring me a bag of gold, I'm going to milk her before I send her home.
Milk her for anything.
There you go.
She'll go home. She will not be an utter failure. I stooped over alone, but I got that one in there. It got good. How many's ready to give? Anybody ready to give? How many givers do we have? Smile at me. I know that one guy's false teeth hole. I saw him put them in his pocket. Let me pray. Father, in Jesus' name, whatever they decide to do, no pressure. If they don't want to give, that's fine. Father, show them if they want the fullness of what we preach, they have to communicate back to the speaker. You said it, I didn't. You said it up. You can steal information, but you can't steal revelation. And so, Father, I want them to have this revelation. They need to learn to relax and trust in the finished work and let you be faithful and bring it to pass in their life. It takes the struggle out of it. We reach a point, we can't do it. Paul reached that point. I'm weak in myself. Oh, but then's when I'm strong, because I tap into the grace and His ability. So tonight in Jesus' name, I thank you for the giving. The spirit of giving rests on these people in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
You're making out a check tonight, make it out to the church. Make out a check, make it out to the church. It'll all go into one check and we'll be thankful and go to your account. Did y'all enjoy revival?
Oh, yes.
Okay, we're through preaching now. The reason I can tell on me, because I know me. For 30 years, God tried to get me to do more ministry one-on-one and go out in the audience and do this and do that. Drag my feet for 30 years. Because I was afraid of what people think. We have documented proof where people that received our prayer calls dying of cancer was healed. Town Henderson. Locked in their house, afraid to go outside. Dave Buchanan. When you call names, you're telling the truth. A little baby in Louisville, his body couldn't absorb food. Gave it a prayer call. It lived, began to gain weight. The Lord said, I want you to start giving people prayer calls. Have them to focus it. Put it on their garments. Wear it. Focus it. Put in your billfold, you'll never be broke again. Put in your car, you'll never have an accident. I'm serious. I'm serious. There's something about the fourth realm flowing over into a prayer call, and you focus on special miracles. Let me tell you where we're headed. We've had eardrums created. We've had limbs created. Now, y'all see a man up here who looks like he works for Long John Silver's. But I see a man with creative miracles. Amen. We're on the verge of it. Yes. Well, we ain't going to stop.
No.
Don't get mad at me. Some of your major preachers wear hearing aids. Some of your major preachers has heart trouble. Some of your major preachers died of heart trouble.
Yes.
He wants you to press through that realm to get it so it can start being manifest for other people. Shortly, very soon, you will see limbs created, arms created, and you talk about a crowd. He's saving the best for two to us. Saving the best for last. How do you believe that?
Yes.
Well, believe with me. And if you got a prayer call, and when your miracle manifests, either email me or write a white mail. I want to document the miracles. Because he's told me for years, start using prayer calls. It's finally dawned on me. That's probably what I ought to do. I don't know why we don't do what he says. I intended and intended and intended.
I hear you.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's get it done. And so when your miracle manifests, you just go ahead and let us know. We're going to journal people. And if you want to put it on Facebook, we'll repost it and share your miracle with everybody on Facebook.
Amen.
Is that all right?
Yes.
Did they take the offering? Y'all glad y'all gave?
Yes.
Y'all enjoyed revival?
Yes.
Well, give the Lord your best shout.
Hallelujah!
Back that up. I'm done. Glory, sister. You go ahead.
Amen. That was awesome.
Yeah.
I'm on. Yep.
Really?
I just want to share real quickly. A few years ago, when Brother Begley was here, he did, he also took up an offering, and he asked us to break that thing. I gave $10,000 that time, and it was very shortly after I got a check for $30,000.
Wow,
I bought it from an aunt in Holland that I'd met twice.
Wow.
Didn't really know her at all,
wow.
But she passed away and left me $30,000.
Wow.
So I know it works.
Yes.
So I'm not afraid to give, so I just want to encourage you. Maybe you missed out and you just want to run back and give the counter to say, how am I get in on this? It works.
It
works. Some people think it's a con game. It's not a con game. It works. Bible says, whatever man sows, that shall you reap. That was a money sow seed I sowed. I wasn't expecting to get corn back. I was expecting to get money back. Amen?
Amen.
God is good. Well, we just praise God for having Brother Dale here. It's been amazing. It's been awesome. I wish we could put our teachings on YouTube. Do we?
Yes, we do.
We do. Praise God. That's what I listen to when I'm working. So that's good. And do we do podcasts?
Not yet.
I can.
Because those are amazing, too, to just download. Because you can listen to those anywhere. You don't need Wi-Fi for that. So anyways, I encourage you to listen to these teachings over and over and over. This was amazing what was being taught.
Yes.
Believe me, you only probably got 2%.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I know I only got 2% of what was being taught. I have to go over this. But there's something there that is really life-changing.
Mm-hmm.
It'll set you free.
Yeah.
It'll set me free.
Amen.
You know? So that's just awesome. I can't say any more, but God's been good. It's been wonderful to have Pastor Mark and Alice here too.
Yes.
And many of you pastors have come, and it's just been a real blessing, and this has been a great turnout every night, and it's just been, it's been wonderful. It's been encouraging and just uplifting. Amen?
Amen?
So why don't we just stand up and thank the Lord for His goodness. Father, we just give You the glory, God. We give You the praise, Lord. We thank You, God, for the words that went forth, Lord. God, those words that were released into the atmosphere. Father God, those words are hitting our spirits, they're hitting our minds, Lord, they're hitting our flesh, Lord, they're hitting all parts of us, God. But Lord, may Your word come down deep in our spirit, Lord. May it change us, Lord, from glory to glory, Lord. And as we pursue, Lord, seeking Your face and learning You and understanding You, God, we just give You praise and glory. Father, we want to go deeper. We want to go higher. We want to be more dedicated. We want to, Lord, be more on purpose to serve You than we ever had before, Lord. So, Father, I ask You, put a hunger in the people's hearts tonight. Every person that's here, put a hunger in their heart, God, to be in the house of the Lord, to be under anointed teachings. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.